Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Good evening. Good evening. Please join me in welcoming tonight's MC. You know him from Western Center's Poverty Is Not a Joke event. He was recently named a fresh new face of comedy at Just for Laughs Festival in Montreal. Hailing from Flint, Michigan, and now sharing his talents as a comedian, writer, and 3D animator right here in Los Angeles. Ladies and gentlemen, can we please have your attention as you welcome Chica Robinson.
Thank you, thank you. Good evening and thank you. As a friend and partner to Western Center on Law and Poverty, it is a privilege and a pleasure to be with you all this evening as we break bread and celebrate tonight's exceptional honorees. Let's just give them a round of applause just off the start. Now, so, as I said, thank you all for joining us here in the ballroom, in the courtyard, and online as we celebrate Western Center's 56 years of fighting in the courts, cities, counties, and in the capital to secure housing, health care, and a strong safety net for Californians with low income. Yes, it's a beautiful thing, you know? Each year we gather, Western Center lifts up both the challenges and the hard-fought wins we have collectively secured. This year, Western Center fought and secured four landmark settlements to advance racial justice, keep California safely housed, return the collection of unjust fines and fees that strip families of their precious assets, and ensure charity care policies are enforced so Californians with low income don't carry the burden of medical debt. Just last week, despite a state deficit, Western Center passed four bills this session enhancing tenant protections, access to health care, yes, and elevation of unjust debt. And at the federal level, Western Center moved quickly to ensure 40 million Americans did not lose their food benefits in the face of a government shutdown. Yes. True heroes. Which resulted in the USDA changing their accounting practice to ensure that benefits will go out this and every October, regardless of a shutdown. Yes. Can I ask that the staff of Western Center to just stand? Stand up. Yes. Now, I also would like to ask the Western Center Board of Directors to please stand to be recognized. Where you at? Yeah, represent. Yes. Thank you all for your dedication and leadership. Now, as people who live and breathe this work, it was incredible to see the public policies like the Earned Income Tax Credit, the Child Tax Credit, tenant eviction protections, and rental assistance programs. And expanded CalFresh and Medi-Cal coverage led to a measurable decrease in the number of families experiencing poverty as we work to stabilize families during the pandemic. However, a rush to get back to normal quickly squandered those gains. Census data from this year confirmed what we all in this room knew was coming. This is the single largest one-year jump in poverty. We went from a record low poverty rate of 7.8% and a child poverty rate of 5.2% to a current nationwide rate of 12.4% and 13.2% here in California. Let's take a moment to sit with that. The largest single year jump in poverty in history. These new numbers point to something that we should not take for granted. We've actually witnessed what it takes to end poverty. We know what the tools are to end poverty, and we know that poverty is a policy choice. And so we thank you for being here, for lending your support to Western Center, for being a part of this journey of moving forward those tools, the policies and laws needed to end poverty so that Californians can strive. Tonight, we'll be celebrating and hearing from those who have journeyed with and inspired Western Center in the pursuit of economic and racial justice, individuals of vision, courage, and commitment. Now, to start things off, I'd like to invite one of those individuals to the stage, a 2009 Guardian Party Award recipient, Western Center on Law and Poverty's Executive Director, Crystal Crawford.
Good evening, everyone. So good to see you. It's been a busy day, but I'm just so glad to be here celebrating Western Center's 56th year in operation. Is that not amazing? And I want to say, Chike, thank you for that introduction, and thank you for stepping in tonight to be our MC. We so appreciate it. Many of you know that former Stockton Mayor Michael Tubbs, who's a senior advisor to Gavin Newsom and founder of EPIC, Ending Poverty in California, on whose advisory board I serve. He's a friend and a mentee of mine, and I'm so proud of him. But last year, he was our MC and did such a great job that we told him he had a forever gig. He had something urgent come up, and he wasn't able to be here with us tonight, and Chike pivoted and said, I'll be there, what do you all need? And we just want to say thank you for stepping in and blessing us with your presence and your talent. I want to say that Mayor Tubbs says to send his regards to everyone, and he will be back next year. He said, don't give away my spot, I will be back next year. I want to, you know, I've been reflecting on kind of the founding of Western Center 56 years ago, and many of you know that this year we celebrated two really, really important anniversaries. The 60th anniversary of the March on Washington, which was August 28th, 1963, and then the 60th anniversary of the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama, where those four little girls were murdered. I'm gonna read their names and ask us to have a moment of silence in their memory. Their names are Addie Mae Collins, Denise McNair, Carol Robertson, and Cynthia Wesley. Can we have a moment of silence in tribute to them? A few years after that horrific event in Birmingham, Western Center was birthed in the aftermath of the Watts uprising, because the folks that were co-founders, some of which are with us today and one you will hear from a little bit later on, said, wait a minute, we've got to do something. We've got to make a difference in trying to turn this country around to eliminate racism and anti-blackness and all of the things that were plaguing our country. Well, I will tell you a highlight for me this year was one of our funders urged me and a few other grantees, including Myra Alvarez from the Children's Partnership, who is a co-sponsor this evening of this event, they urged us to go to Birmingham, Alabama for a convening. Now, you know an ED of an organization, I have so much to do. I'm like, I've been to Birmingham before, so I was like, should I go to Birmingham? I am so glad that that funder encouraged us, paid the way, of course, for us to go to Birmingham to meet and to think about how we might do work better together, how we might strategize, and to actually be there on the anniversary of the 60th anniversary of the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham. I tell you, I will never forget that experience. As many of you know who may have seen it on C-SPAN, Justice KBJ, as I call her, Ketanji Brown Jackson, was the keynote speaker and said she could not turn down that invitation because it was such an important historic event to memorialize. And so as we think about the work of Western Center, we think about these important 60th anniversaries, we think about how they led to the founding of Western Center, I think about some of the historic things that have happened this year in California. I think about the California Reparations Task Force releasing that awesome 1,100-page report documenting the history of oppression of black folk here in California and across the country. I, as part of the Western Center team, was involved in monitoring and supporting that work and just really walking alongside the task force. And our new Director of Policy Advocacy, Brandon Green, who couldn't be here tonight, was actually an expert witness who testified before the California Reparations Task Force. And we have a member of the California Reparations Task Force in the house here with us tonight. Would you please raise your hand, Lisa Holder? She is also the president of the Equal Justice Society. She took the baton from Eva Paterson, who will be getting an award a little bit later. And the work of that task force was historic. And it's not an accident that that work was completed in this 60th anniversary of both the March on Washington and the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham. So it is a historic year here in California with the Reparations Task Force report, and now we gotta take action on their recommendations. And Western Center will be right there, partnering with our community partners, partnering with legislators to figure out how we can bring that important report to life and actually put into practice some things that will right some of the wrongs that this country has imposed upon people of color and Black folks specifically. The other thing I wanted to lift up that's really historic this year in connection to the murder of the four little girls was the recent signing by Governor Newsom of the Ebony Alert legislation. I don't know if you all know about this, but Black women and girls are not searched for and looked for when they're missing at the level of our white counterparts and other communities. And it's been a real problem. There's been a film about it called Black and Missing. There's another TV show I understand currently on about it. So we now have legislation in this year where these four little girls were murdered. We have legislation that says Black women and girls are prioritized when they're missing, when they are abused or abducted in some way. Again, no accident, right? All of these connections. And the last thing I will bring up is just the importance of us as a team at Western Center and beyond really being intentional about our racial justice framework, our racial justice analysis, and being unashamedly aggressive about attacking racism and lifting up anti-Blackness. I tell you, as an ED of this organization, I experience anti-Blackness related encounters and issues and situations several times each day. And it just, you know, it's that weathering that happens to Black folks when we're in these leadership positions, when we're in other positions where it just wears you down over time because you are constantly being bombarded by anti-Blackness. So as we have this opportunity to put the California Reparations Task Force recommendations in operation, in an acknowledgement of the 60th year anniversaries that I've lifted up, I am just really excited about the ways that Western Center is going to partner and make a difference in those regards. Couple final thoughts before I move on to present our first presenter. Few thoughts to leave you with, couple nuggets. Poverty is a form of violence. Poverty is a form of violence. What it does to people, to families, to people's self-esteem, to their ability to make a way for their families and for themselves is literally violence. Another nugget to leave you with, only policy can fix what policy created, right? We lifted up earlier policy is a poverty choice. I mean, we lifted up that poverty is a policy choice, right? But only policy can fix what policy created. And then the final nugget is that we just need all of you to continue to partner with us to stand against systems of oppression, intersecting systems. We'll hear a little bit more later on about the awesome inaugural Derrick Bell Award and, you know, the whole question of intersectionality and systems and oppression is critically important as we do this work and move forward and try to be effective. Last thing I'd like to do before I call up our next voice that you'll hear from is to thank you. Thank you for all of your support. You all are the reason that we're here tonight, the reason we can do the work. Without your financial support, we could not do what we do. And I think about, are there any Earth, Wind, and Fire fans in the house? So I think about the album Gratitude, which came out when I was in elementary school, and we, every day after school, would play it over and over and over and sing all the songs. You know, the heart of gratitude that we have for you, our supporters, you know, I have to stretch out my arms to really exhibit the depth and the breadth of the gratitude that we have for you. So thank you so much for your support. Every dollar makes a difference. Every dollar makes a difference. I do want to call out a few of our sponsors who put some extra dollars in the mix because they really help kind of ground our fundraising work. So I just want to call their names quickly, but know that we appreciate every single dollar, every single sponsor, every single ticket purchase. Champions are Baker McKenzie, Kirkland and Ellis, Latham and Watkins, Munger, Tolles and Olson, Torchbearer, City National Bank, DLA Piper and Wilson Sonsini, and the defenders, Bird Morella, Crowell and Mooring, Felicia Davis and Eric Gutschel, Gibson Dunn, Houston Hennigan, Paul Hastings, and Skadden Arps. Can we give them an extra round of applause for putting a little bit of extra money in the pot that really help us do what we do? And I would love to call many more of your names on this list of the extra givers next year. But whatever you can give, we really do appreciate it. And please know that we believe in not necessarily having favoritism towards those who give a lot more, but we do understand they really make a big difference, right? The last thing I wanted to say is, we who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. Sweet Honey in the Rock, Ella Baker, that's my theme song, and we really, really need to embrace that and allow it to encourage us and move this work forward as we do it together. So thank you for all you do for Western Center. We so appreciate you. And now I have the privilege of introducing one of our senior attorneys who I've gotten to know pretty well over the last 3 years, and she is just a phenomenal, phenomenal person, committed woman to social justice, and just a pleasure to be around. So when the opportunity to be a presenter tonight was offered to her, she said, I'll do it. This is an honor. So Lorraine Lopez is a senior attorney, a specialist in housing, and has been with the Western Center several years now, a storied career, and we are just so blessed and fortunate to have her on our team now. So the next voice you will hear is that of Lorraine Lopez. And as Lorraine comes, you know, I have to show you that I have my Derrick Bell reader here in honor of the Derrick Bell Award. And if you all need to catch up on your Derrick Bell reading, please join me. I am doing that and refreshing my recollection related to all of the wonderful things he taught us. Lorraine, we're in your hands.
Crystal, for the introduction. As Crystal said, my name is Lorraine Lopez. I am one of the I am one of the senior attorneys here at Western Center on Law and Poverty. I have the pleasure tonight of introducing our first honoree, Yolanda Arias. Yolanda, alongside from being a dear friend and partner to Western Center, wears many hats as a litigator, mentor, and trainer around issues like public benefits, medical debt, foster care, and immigration. I've known Yolanda throughout my career by her reputation, not only as a legal expert, but as a supportive and kind mentor to many attorneys in legal services. As a fellow Latina attorney, Yolanda serves as an example of leadership and perseverance, leadership, perseverance, and longevity in a field where we are too often underrepresented, especially in management positions. As I progressed in my career, I have benefited from her trainings and wealth of knowledge. I have also had the pleasure to work with many of her colleagues who spoke of her in the highest regard. I am personally and professionally honored to share the stage with her and to celebrate her career in legal services. Because of her dedication to advancing justice in our community, our team of attorneys unanimously and enthusiastically chose Yolanda for the Mary Burdick Advocates Award, recognizing our previous executive director who argued two of three U.S. Supreme Court cases ever argued by Western Center's attorneys. Mary fought tirelessly to protect Western Center in the face of political attacks and also created the Garden Party, which we are celebrating today. Yolanda, it is such an honor to present you with the Mary Burdick Advocate Award. Before Yolanda comes up, we do have a special surprise as well. She has a message from someone who also wears many hats and is a well-known superhero who has recorded a celebration for you, Yolanda. So without further ado, we're going to play a video from you from Xolo Maridueña.
For over five decades, Western Center on Law and Poverty has fought for racial and economic justice alongside civil rights activists and freedom fighters. My name is Xolo Maridueña. I'm an actor, producer, podcaster, lover, and it is with great pleasure that today I get to celebrate one of those freedom fighters, Yolanda Arias. Yolanda, thank you so much for your work, for all that you do, helping those in poverty, helping our immigrant communities, and for being a role model for people like myself, aspiring superheroes. You are a real hero, and I thank you for it. I'd also like to thank the Western Center of Law and Poverty for this opportunity. And yeah, congrats, Yolanda. Ciao.
Thank you so much. I feel a little bit cooler being introduced by Xolo. When I heard that I was going to be given the Mary Burdick Advocates Award, I was honored. And when I heard that the decision was unanimous among the Western Center staff, I was proud and humbled at the same time. To me, the Western Center attorneys, some of whom I've worked with my entire legal career, are superstars. Robert Newman, I don't know where you're at. Richard Rothschild have been my co-counsel, teachers, and mentors. Jody Berger has been a role model my entire career. Antoinette, David, Helen, and so many others over the years have been valued colleagues in our joint struggle to achieve justice for so many members of our community. One of the first lawsuits that I worked on with Bob Newman was a class action that helped thousands of pregnant women get timely access to prenatal care, to Medi-Cal, and get proper prenatal care. Lynn Kersey is here. She remembers that, I'm sure, because it came through maternal and child health access. Another case I worked on early in my career with Western Center and the ACLU was suing the federal government to help the victims of the 1992 LA uprising get emergency food stamps after their neighborhoods were torn apart by unrest, fires, and power outages. And more recently, I worked with my LAFLA colleagues, Andrew Kazakis and Tyler Press, and we partnered with Dick Rothschild and Alex Prieto to change a state policy to allow victims of electronically stolen food stamps to get those critically needed benefits replaced. There's so many, thanks. There are so many other cases that I've had the great good fortune to work on with my colleagues at LAFLA and Western Center. Together with Sylvia Argueta, our executive director, and Elena Akel from LAFLA, and along with our co-counsel Yolanda Vera at the time, And with Western Center working on a companion case, we helped keep Rancho Los Amigos Rehabilitation Center open for the disabled individuals who desperately were in need of their services and still are. Working with my treasured colleague, Marjorie Shelby, Lafla was able to win a Ninth Circuit decision to get children in foster care living with relatives access to much needed foster care benefits. It's truly a special feeling to have participated in actions that positively impact so many lives. Together, our organizations, LAFLA and Western Center, have fought for the rights of our clients not only through lawsuits, but by working with our clients to get their voices heard, advocating with government agencies, working with legislators and community organizations to change policy and remove systemic barriers to life-saving and life-changing services and benefits. I'm so proud to continue this work with my LAFLA colleagues and my Economic Stability Workgroup team members, some of whom are here today. I'm thankful to have their support. I'm so grateful to have worked with so many talented, knowledgeable, and compassionate attorneys and advocates who have been so generous with their time and shared so much of their expertise with me. I've been fortunate to work with people who care so deeply about making sure that members of our community have the necessities of life, housing, medical care, food, equal opportunities to services, jobs, and education. I'm proud to continue working beside these individuals. They are true heroes. I dedicate this award to my husband, Erwin Klaproth, who was my support throughout my life, through college, throughout my law school and legal career. He always encouraged me to keep going through the tough times. And my family, my sons, Michael, Evan, and Gabriel, and my daughters-in-law and soon-to-be daughters-in-law, Alicia, Diana, and Lisa. I couldn't get through any of this without your love and support. And finally, thank you, Western Center, for this great honor. I will strive to continue to be worthy of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Yolanda, for your service and for getting the program off on an inspirational start. Let's just give her another round of applause. Truly amazing. Does a lot of work to ensure that Californians are treated with dignity and receive the fullest and finest protection under the law. And we thank you for your tremendous history and service. Before we continue to our next honoree, I would be remiss to not draw your attention to the screen and to the cards on the tables. Because as you can see here, we also want to raise funds for Western Center's work. So please take a moment during tonight's show to text WCLP23 to 41444 to make a donation or scan the QR code on the screen or at the stands at your table to go directly to the donation page. Now, I'd like to invite to the stage Madeline Howard. Western Center's, yes, yes, already hype. Western Center's senior housing attorney to present this year's Max Gillam Pro Bono Award to an exceptional firm who joined forces with Western Center this year to secure a massive win for California tenants. Madeline, please take it away.
Hi, everybody. Surprise, I'm short for all of you who've only met me on Zoom. But seriously, good evening. It's so nice to be with everyone in person. It is my great honor tonight to recognize Covington and Burling, who joined as pro bono counsel in ACE versus the Department of Housing and Community Development. This is litigation that arose during the pandemic from a really pivotal issue, the $6 billion emergency rental assistance program. We're really glad to have our amazing clients and our co-counsel team in the house tonight. Western Center, Public Counsel, and LAFLA filed this case on behalf of organizing groups ACE and SAGE and Research Equity, yes, and Research Equity Group Policy Link to enforce the right for people applying for rental assistance to get constitutional due process and to enforce the right for the public to know who is benefiting from this program. The program was supposed to help low-income tenants who were not able to pay their rent because of COVID, but it was fraught with problems from the very beginning. And we didn't seek pro bono counsel initially because it was supposed to be a simple writ. We filed in a court that schedules writs in 6 months. We thought we could just get the money out the door to people who needed it, but surprise. So while Covington worked tirelessly on all aspects of the litigation, their contribution was particularly critical with respect to the discovery that ultimately really shifted the dynamic in the case and allowed us to come to resolution. Their advocacy was instrumental, particularly in uncovering the evidence of wrongful denials that forced the state to settle. So their strategic insights were invaluable, and they were incredibly generous with their time as well. Well over 2,000 hours and counting, we're still going. And on several occasions, Covington partner Nima Sani, you're gonna be in a minute, assisted us on, yes, on key decisions when she was on the other side of the world. So thank you for that. We spent way too many nights late on Zoom when we all wanted to be asleep. And while I'm not gonna mention every single Covington attorney who worked on this case because there are so many that it would take all my time because they were so generous, I do have to mention in particular what a privilege it was to work with Nima. She is such a fierce litigator and truly a force to be reckoned with, and I'm so glad we got to partner. I hope we're never on the opposite side of anything. So as a result of this advocacy, we finally saw thousands of tenant families who have been waiting so long for help finally get the assistance that they needed just in the past few months since the settlement was finalized. And Covington is continuing to work with us as we face ongoing challenges in settlement implementation. You might hear more about that later. So it is with deep gratitude that I present the 2023 Max Gillam Pro Bono Award to Covington and Burling. It's gonna be accepted by Nima Sani for the tremendous work of this team to keep Californians safely housed. Please join me in welcoming Nima to the stage.
To Madeline for lowering the mics for me. We are at the same level. First, let me say thank you to the Western Center for this lovely evening. Congratulations on another successful garden party and for your decades of leadership in the legal services community in Los Angeles. And congratulations to all of tonight's honorees. On behalf of the Covington team, I am deeply honored and humbled to receive this recognition. Covington as a firm has had a long and rich tradition of supporting pro bono work and championing pro bono efforts around the world. Those efforts are anchored in serving economically disadvantaged individuals and families in our surrounding communities. And when several of us in this room opened our office in LA over 8 years ago, we all shared a deep commitment to serving the most vulnerable populations here in Los Angeles in partnership with wonderful organizations like the Western Center and others in the room. In the ERAP litigation, the firm once again displayed its complete and unwavering commitment to taking on high-impact pro bono litigation like this. As Madeline mentioned, the case was extremely hard fought by the state and at times required a team of lawyers on both coasts working around the clock. And I never once questioned whether the firm would give us the support and full resources needed to engage in the litigation. I also have to thank our team of dedicated and talented attorneys and staff, several of whom are here and several who could not join tonight. Support from the firm doesn't mean a lot if you don't have people willing to step up and bring the fight. Jeff, Jack, and others, you brought the fight, and I'm grateful to you all. And I'd like to commend the creativity, tenacity, and the commitment of our associate team in particular. Next, I want to thank our amazing co-counsel at the Western Center, LAFLA, and Public Counsel. Yeah, everybody clap for that. That deserves it. Talk about a dedicated, fierce group of advocates. Madeline, Dick, Lorraine, Fiza, Greg, Jonathan, thank you for your partnership and for your tireless efforts to support tenant families in Los Angeles. It was truly a privilege for all of us to work with you. And a special shout out to the whole Western Center team for this hour and honor and their leadership on this matter. Madeline, let me say in particular that you are the very definition of a warrior, a champion, and a truly remarkable advocate. And I too do not want to be on the other side of a litigation with you. Finally, to our clients at Ace and Sage and all the tenants and families you advocate for, and I see Edna over there, thank you for entrusting us to partner with you on this matter. The pandemic affected all of us in myriad ways, but for many of us in this room, that meant having to mask, getting vaccines, social distancing, family reunions on Zoom. But for the tenant families at the heart of this case, the pandemic threatened not only their health, but also their livelihoods and their homes. They faced crippling debt, fear of eviction, and homelessness. And many of those impacts continue on even today. So amidst all those discovery tussles that Madeline mentioned and the tense settlement talks and all the other daily struggles of litigation, our clients and our co-counsel always kept these individuals and families at the forefront of the fight, focusing on how to obtain the much-needed rental assistance that would keep hundreds of thousands of Californians in their homes. We are so very appreciative of Western Center, our clients, and the full co-counsel team for inviting Covington to be part of that effort. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nima. Give her another round of applause. Another round of applause. There we go. I know many attorneys here tonight are curious about how they can get involved, and your passion and impact in this case has undoubtedly inspired them to explore this level of pro bono work. And I'd like to welcome another leader at Western Center to come to the stage, Ray Rodriguez. Yeah. There was more, Ray. Western Center's board member, chair of the development committee, and counsel at Walt Disney Studios, one of tonight's sponsors. Ray, tell us why you're here tonight.
I don't know if you've ever had the chance to see Chike do his comedy. He's amazing. So I highly recommend that you go out and look out for his work. You won a special award, I think, right? Yeah. And he was part of, we had a fundraiser for, Poverty is Not a Joke. Yeah, GK was there, and he did a great job. Really extraordinary work. So I'm here because we need you. And, we want to thank you for everything that you've done. But we need you, and especially we need your money. So one of the things is that the reason why I serve at Western Center is because, when you drive here, you see the people on the street. You see people without homes. You see people who, tonight we got to eat and we got to enjoy each other and we have places to go back to, and a lot of people in the city don't. And I think One of the things that I feel very deeply about is that we're all interconnected. We need each other. We need everybody in this city, and we need to make sure that everybody's taken care of, because if everybody's not taken care of, then I don't want to live in the type of world where we're forgetting about people. And I know our children want a better world. And I've been on the board 82 years. No, I've been in like eight years. And we have a commitment to racial justice. And one of the movers really was Derrick Bell. I Crystal showed his book, and I really highly recommend that you read what he wrote, because at the time, they would read his work, and he would write a lot of creative writing, and one of the things, they wouldn't take him seriously, because they were saying, why would a law professor write fiction? And the reason why he would write fiction, because it was really nonfiction, because that was the world that we lived in, and maybe if people just read his literature, they would understand the pain that he was suffering and the institutional trauma that really has come upon us because we don't acknowledge systemic racism sufficiently. We don't know our history, and at this moment, we need to do better. So if I could ask you all to please take out your phone. You have those fancy phones? Especially this Covington table, they did extraordinary work. I would take out the phone. If everybody just take out their phone, and then there's a QR code. It's a beautiful thing. You just take a picture of it. It's on the screen, it's at your table. Or you can text WCLP23 to 41444 to make a donation. Now, you know, some of you can make a $5 donation. Everybody can do that. Or you could do a $10 donation. Everybody could do that. Or you could do a $10,000 donation. We'll take that. But anything you give, we appreciate, because as I said, we're all interconnected. We all need each other. And anything you can give, you've seen the incredible work that people are doing, and they're doing it not because they're getting paid, you know, lots of money. It's because they care about this city. And I think this city and this state are really, it's an incredible place. And it is a beacon, especially in this moment where our democracy is. California and how we treat each other is really a representation of the world that we want to live in. And I can't think of a better representation of that than Western Severn Law and Poverty, that's really thinking about all of us and making sure that we live in a society of justice and equality and freedom. So I highly recommend that you give. And with that, I think I will move on. Thank you so much. Chike. I think you're going to get more money, right?
Give it up for Ray, y'all. I love Ray. I love Ray. Ray is amazing.
And a huge, like, thank you to all you generous folks in the audience tonight. Because of your generosity, Western Center is positioned to do great things. So give a round of applause to yourselves as well. And speaking of greatness, our next presenter's impressive 6 decades of public service embodies just that. Now, Western Center's scholar in residence and the namesake of our next award is Justice Earl Johnson. Justice Johnson served as an Associate Justice of the Court of Appeal, Second Appellate District for 25 years, after leading the Office of Equal Opportunity Legal Services Program, which later became the Legal Services Corporation, a program he was instrumental in creating as part of President Lyndon Johnson's War on Poverty. Please put your hands together and welcome the legendary Justice Earl Johnson.
I'm here to present the award to a... Closer, okay. Now, second time. I'm here to present the award to a woman who is a great contributor to equal access to justice in this country and in California in particular. Her name is Eva Paterson. and she and I have at least one thing in common. She was elected president of the student body at Northwestern University in 1969, and I was elected to that same office in 1954. She, however, was the very first African-American woman to achieve that position in what was still a nearly all white student body. Okay. When I was there at Northwestern in the mid-1950s, there were not one African-American woman in the student body, and only a couple of African-American men. One of those, Henry McGee, pioneered the road for Eva when he was the first African-American elected to serve on the 15-member student governing board at Northwestern. Much later, Henry McGee spent a quarter century as a UCLA law professor. It's the same person as may be familiar to many of you. Eva was raised in a military family, the daughter of a warrant officer who was stationed at various times in England, France, and the US. She early on displayed the speech-making skills that helped make her career. As a student, she delivered Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech at high schools all around the state she lived in. Eva took office as Northwestern student body president during a turbulent time on American campuses. Students were protesting the Vietnam War everywhere, including Northwestern. Then several student protesters were shot and killed at Kent State, and the Northwestern student body erupted. Some were urging the crowd of several thousand to burn down the NROTC building on campus. Eva stood before them and used her well-honed leadership skills to channel the collective anger into less violent and more productive courses of action. So she saved the Navy. Let's let her to be called the Peaceful Warrior. Eva's success at Northwestern was just a precursor of her leadership on many fronts. While still a student, she was chosen to oppose Vice President Spiro Agnew in a televised debate about the Vietnam War. She then went, after college, she went to the law school, the University of California, Berkeley, and when she left there, she joined the staff at the Legal Aid Society of Alameda County. Well, there, Eva co-founded a safe place, which was a shelter for battered women. Then she joined the staff of the San Francisco Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights and soon became its executive director. Among other achievements during that time, Eva was co-lead counsel in a lawsuit that succeeded in desegregating the San Francisco Fire Department. Continuing her pattern of creating new institutions, Eva co-founded and chaired the California Coalition for Civil Rights, and from that podium was a leading spokesman in the campaigns to defeat Propositions 187 and 209, and in other campaigns against the death penalty and discrimination of lesbians and gay men. At the national level, Eva served as vice president of the ACLU National Board for 8 years. Then, in the year 2000, Eva founded the Equal Justice Society and served as its president for the next 22 years. Under her leadership, the society employs litigation, social science research, and public policy advocacy to advance civil rights and anti-discrimination initiatives. Eva has not only won plaudits for her creative and charismatic leadership, but for her skills as a lawyer. One San Francisco newspaper named her one of the top 25 lawyers in that city. Another publication called her the go-to lawyer for civil rights litigation And yet another observer simply said she was among the best lawyers in the city. I realize that this Equal Justice Award will join over 50 other awards Eve of Paterson has already received. But how more appropriate could it be that this Equal Justice Award is going to the founder of the Equal Justice Society?
Hello, greetings from Oakland. I have been very nervous about today because I come from the 20th century and Zoom and all this stuff. I was wondering, how's this gonna work? But I must say that I'm riffing off so many things that people have been saying tonight. Crystal talked about gratitude. When I was thinking about tonight, I was thinking that I'm filled with gratitude and love. But listening to all the speakers and hearing what the Western Center has done fills me with a sense of joy, which is also something that Crystal talked about. I retired a year ago, and now I call myself an OG. Ask younger people what that means, or older people. But it was so delightful to listen to all the young people who basically validated why I retired, because I know there are younger people who share my values, who have energy, who have power, and tonight all of that was on display. I'd like to thank the fellow honorees. Ms. Arias, as Earl Johnson said, I started my career as a law student and as a baby lawyer in legal services. I was the first Black lawyer that many people had seen in East Oakland. And I remember thinking that we're called lawyers and counselors at law. And something that Ms. Arias conveyed as she accepted her award and as people talked about her was the counseling part of it. The lady from Covington and Burling touched on the same thing. Poor people and people of color are often in just a world of trouble. And often if they can come to a lawyer and the lawyer can just say, okay, you got this 30-day notice to be evicted, but we can stop that. Or, oh, there's a creditor coming after you, or they didn't follow all the laws. Oh, you were supposed to get some housing money and the state didn't do it, we can help you. So Ms. Arias, I think you represent that aspect of our profession. Covington and Burling, I worked for the Lawyers Committee in San Francisco, which is the analog of public counsel. And I know that without firms like yours, and also many of the firms who have given money tonight, we couldn't get our work done. When the lady was talking about the help with discovery, I'm just thinking of the boxes and boxes and boxes that are often dumped on public interest lawyers. And you all at the big firms don't flinch because you know how to do it, time stamping, all that, bait stamp, I think that's what it is. I've been retired for a little bit. So thank you to Covington and Burling and all the firms out there who do pro bono work. We need you. And we know you also like this work. It's good work. Harry and Gina Belafonte, I was watching a special on Black comedians, and they talked about the fact that Black comedians see themselves as activists first and then comedians. And I think that's what you and your father felt. Mr. Belafonte was so amazing. He was in a lot of the footage, marching on Washington at the funeral of Dr. King. He was everywhere doing God's work, if you will. And I think that became more important to him than the film work. Although I must say on the shallow side, I was in love with your father, as I'm sure many people were. And my favorite scene from him was in Carmen Jones, when he's driving Dorothy Dandridge to, I guess, be arrested or something. And they're singing, There's a Cafe on the Corner. My parents had that record and played that a lot. So your father has been in my soul for a long time. And thank you and thank him. And he did so much. I'm so sorry that he passed on. The Western Center, I must say, it's a great institution. Mr. Rodriguez talked about it as a beacon, and that's what I was going to say as well. It's as though when you put up the bat signal, Western Center is going to be there, and they're going to do great work, and they're fierce, and they get great results. So it's a double honor to get this award from you all. I must also say that you need to give Crystal a big raise. She's fabulous. She's delightful. She has a great depth of understanding of oppression and how to overcome it. She's doing great work on fundraising. And she also educated me and some of the IT people who were helping me be in the 21st century tonight, Diallo, Dewan, and Jacore. She was telling me that Derrick Bell was the first executive director of the Western Center. I never knew that. And Mr. Rodriguez, I'm so glad you talked about his work on anti-Blackness and his work of fiction. He wrote this article called The Space Traders, and some of you may know about it, but the premise is that people from another planet come to America and they say, we will cure your disease. We will give you untold wealth. If you just give us all the Black people and let us take them away, but you may never ask what we're going to do with them. And I thought, Derrick, you're just so negative. Nothing, things aren't that bad in America. Well, 30 years from then, I know that maybe there would be people who would send us away. So Derrick, he was a fighter, and I'm so glad he was head of the Western Center, and I may have to pick up that reader as well. And then Terry Hatter was a buddy of my dad's, because my dad was an administrator at Legal Aid in St. Louis after he came back from the war in Vietnam. You also gave us Mona Tawatow, who's one of the best people on earth. Hi, Mona. Hi, Lisa Holder, who's the head of EJS. And hi, Priscilla Ochen. They're all people connected with the Equal Justice Society. Just a couple more things I want to say. I was asking Crystal how long I should say, talk. She said, well, you can talk for 7 minutes, but you don't have to talk that long. And I've often quipped that I was a, and some of you younger people may not get this, but I was a magna cum laude graduate of the Fidel Castro School of Public Speaking. I love to talk, but Crystal said, keep it short, so I will. One of the delights about this evening was getting to know Earl Johnson. He's an amazing man. He kind of opened the road for me at Northwestern and in legal services in California. He also fought the mob in Las Vegas. I know we're supposed to be talking about poverty and racism, but he's pretty tough if he was fighting the mob on behalf of the Department of Justice in Las Vegas. He also started legal services, so it was a delight to get to know him. There are two things I want to say in conclusion that I want to put on your hearts. And Mr. Rodriguez talked about this. Our democracy is in big trouble. There are authoritarian waves sweeping across the country. There is a strong anti-democratic feeling in this country. And we have to do all we can to preserve our democracy. One of the things that we can do is talk with people who may like authoritarianism. I want to share one brief anecdote with you. When I entered Northwestern in 1967, the year that Western Center was formed, I was in favor of the war. And I actually said these words to fellow students who were leaving to go to Wisconsin to work for Eugene McCarthy. I said and believed, well, the President of the United States says we have to go to war, and if the President says it, then we must do this. By the summer, I was getting tear gas at the Democratic Convention, took over a building at Northwestern, and came out against the war, because I was worked on and listened to people who I respected, but I didn't agree with them at first, but they kept getting to me with good arguments. And when Bobby Kennedy came out against the war, I got there too. What I'm saying is many of you will know people who are inclined to go towards authoritarianism. Don't just give up on them. Some of them, if they're racist people, forget it. That's a waste of your time. But there may be people who you can convince to do the right thing. As it's often said, democracy is not a spectator sport, and we've got to fight tooth and nail to preserve our democracy. My final comment will be this. Ken Burns has a fabulous series on called The American Buffalo, and he's very kind of tricky because it's not really about the buffalo. It is, but it's also about how horrible we were to indigenous people. But one of the things that's said by one of the indigenous people is, I'll paraphrase it, it's that we are responsible for 7 generations to come. And so what I want to say is that we are destroying Mother Earth. This summer was horrifying. You guys had a hurricane in Southern California. We were all worried for you. There have been fires, droughts, floods, insane stuff going on. And it won't do us any good to have good housing for people, have people free from racism, if we destroy the planet. So I'm retired now, and so I have a kind of a different perspective on things, but I think it's really important for us to take care of Mother Earth. It's our home. So anyway, I'm really happy to get this award. I wish I could be there. I'm in Northern California. Western Center rocks. Thank you very much. That's all. Bye.
Just in case anyone didn't know, OG is original gangsta. Just in case there's any confusion. Let's give her another round of applause. She's not here, but you can just feel it. I'm a true believer, and you can just feel the energy sometimes, you know? So we thank her. The talent, experience, and dedication being honored on this stage and online is just incredible. Tonight is truly special. So thank you for all being a part of it here in the ballroom and the courtyard and to those joining us from home. And now I'd like to bring to the stage Stan Levy and Priscilla Ocean. Stan Levy is not only one of the founders of the Western Center on Law and Poverty, he also was the founder of Public Counsel and Bezedek, three powerhouse organizations who have collectively represented hundreds of thousands of low-income individuals and have won some of the most significant legal precedents in American law. Stan is joined tonight by Priscilla Ocean, a professor of law at Loyola Law School. Prior to her appointment there was a critical race studies fellow at UCLA School of Law, studying under Kimberly Crenshaw, who coined the term critical race theory, drawing from the legal foundation set by Derrick Bell. They are here tonight to share what Derrick Bell has meant to them as legal scholars and practitioners, and how his work continues to reverberate through our institutions of higher education, the justice system, and our larger public consciousness. Please welcome Mr. Stan Levy and Professor Ocean.
Derrick Bell was the founding executive director of the Western Center on Law and Poverty. I was a staff attorney at the Western Center at the time when Derrick came to the Western Center. Derrick came to Western Center from the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund, where he had won or supervised more than 300 school desegregation cases. While at the Western Center, Derrick taught at USC Law School. From there, he went to Harvard Law School as the first black professor there. He went on to be dean of the University of Oregon School of Law. 5 years later, he went back to teach at Harvard Law School and then to NYU Law School. Bell's law, textbook was published in 1996 entitled Race, Racism, and the American Legal System, and American Law. He wrote in the preface of the second edition, quote, "The body of civil rights law is now enormous and its impact is substantial. But it is apparent that despite the perennial expectations and hopes, racial problems continue to grow in size, complexity, and importance. And yet, for all the furor that they have caused and the changes in racial patterns and policies attributed to them, these civil rights cases and laws are today increasingly regarded as either obsolete or insufficient. Barack Obama, when he was the president of the Harvard Law Review, wrote, quote, "Bell's scholarship has opened up new vistas and horizons and has changed the standard of what legal writing is all about. Bell's writing also includes a parable, traitors that we've just heard about in 1992, faces at the bottom of the well the permanence of racism. Four cases which Derrick had us file and which he eventually won when he was the executive director was Serrano versus Priest, systemic discrimination in funding for public education, Blair versus Pitches, systemic racism in consumer fraud cases, Ennis versus LAPD, systemic racism in law enforcement, and Crawford versus LA Unified School District, systemic racism in public education. Derrick Bell died on October 5th, 2011, at the age of 80. He was a most important influence in my life and legal career and helped shape my career in civil rights, human rights, poverty law, and as being the second executive director of Western Center. He also helped me shape my life as a person. I am forever indebted to Derrick Bell. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Stan. And thank you to the Western Center, particularly Crystal Crawford, Executive Director. Please give her another round of applause. And also shout out to Eva Paterson. I was board chair of Equal Justice Society, one of the great honors of my career. So I want to congratulate her and the Equal Justice Society staff. I think I saw Mona somewhere just over here and Lisa Holder. Good to see you both. I'm honored to present the inaugural Derrick Bell Legacy Award along with Stan Levy. I first came to know Professor Bell on the page, like many of you. How many of you have read Professor Bell? Okay, not enough hands. We need to see more hands, but thank you to those of you who have. Like you all, I came to know him on the page. Reading his work as a student at UCLA School of Law, shout out to the Bruins in the house. In his seminal works, Serving Two Masters and The Interest Convergence Dilemma, he highlighted the centrality of race in American law and society, challenging the existing orthodoxy of the civil rights movement and constitutional law. He wrote about the use of law to secure power for the few rather than justice for the many. In his writings, I felt seen. While I felt alienated from my law school experience, in his writings, I found a home. In his writings, I saw the experiences of my ancestors who persisted in the face of the legal regimes of chattel slavery, settler colonialism, and Jim Crow. Writing in parables, as you just heard, Professor Bell used stories and narratives that were rooted in the Black radical tradition to defy traditional scholarly frameworks, creating the blueprint for theorizing that would ultimately become critical race theory and inspire concepts like intersectionality. In his work on race, racism, and American law, he changed the face of legal scholarship and legal education, and we are all deeply indebted to him for it. After graduating from law school and becoming a civil rights attorney and legal scholar myself, I continued to look to his words and his life as a model for how to do freedom work. In his life, Bell was guided by a clear sense of fairness and integrity. He was kind and generous and dogged in his determination to fight for the cause of Black liberation. Indeed, his work at the NAACP Legal Defense Fund began only after He left the U.S. Justice Department Civil Rights Division in protest of what it characterized of his membership in the NAACP, calling it a conflict of interest to be both a member of the NAACP and a member of the Justice Department. Integrity and principle were defining features of Professor Bell's career. He left several posts in protest of hiring practices that discriminated against Black women in particular, including his tenured position at Harvard Law. Despite recognizing the centrality of race in American society, Bell did not surrender the fight. He did not get tired. He did not give in to the seduction of hopelessness. Instead, he kept going, secure in the fact that the struggle is its own reward. Can I get an amen? Amen. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Thank you. He did not get tired. He did not give up, and neither will we. Instead, he kept going. He kept fighting. He kept standing in his dignity and humanity in the face of violence and oppression. He, through his work, demonstrated that when we refuse to cooperate in our own oppression, we become free. While some cast him as pessimistic, Bell rejected that characterization of his work. The recognition of the pervasiveness of racism in American society, Bell said, is, quote, far from an invitation to ultimate despair. Instead, he said, and I'm quoting, it can serve as an opportunity for new insight, more effective planning, and a more satisfying life for all of us condemned by color to a subordinate status. Today we gather to celebrate a man who challenged us to think differently about race, the law, and its relationship to American society. And in doing so, he changed the face of law, the legal academy, and the world. And we are deeply indebted to him. So I am so grateful to be here today to announce the Derrick Bell Award. And coming to the stage to present this year's inaugural Derrick Bell Award, please welcome Dr. Gay Teresa Johnson, a UCLA, hey, yes, yes, we need to give her a round of applause, yes. A UCLA professor whose work on race, cultural politics, and freedom struggles includes two incredible books, Spaces of Conflict, Sounds of Solidarity, Music, Race, and Spatial Entitlement, A History of Political Coalition Building and Spatial Struggles Among Black and Brown Freedom Seekers in Los Angeles, and Futures of Black Radicalism. Dr. Teresa Gay Johnson.
Shout out to my incredible table over there. It's quite the honor to be here. I want to thank Sochi Flores for inviting me. Hermana, amazing, amazing friend and incredible ally. The Second World War happened, and my mother told me that the fight against Hitler was our fight, and I went off just like that. We were fighting against tyranny, fighting for freedom. But when we, the black soldiers, came home, we found it was business as usual. There were no changes in the segregation laws. There was no right to vote. And yet being part of that war changed something in us. We'd had a peek at freedom. I knew if I could fight for it over there, I could fight for it in America. This is Harry Belafonte, quoted by Derrick Bell in Silent Covenants, Brown v. Board of Education, and the Unfulfilled Hopes for Racial Reform. How lucky to have encountered this quote when I was thinking about the connection between the inaugural Derrick Bell Award and its honorees, Gina and Harry Belafonte, and how fitting it is that these two are its recipients. If you study the arc of Derrick Bell's engagement with civil rights and racial justice, you can quickly become uncomfortable with his transparency about his own disillusionment with racial and legislative reform. You see, because despite supervising more than 300 school desegregation cases, early on, Derrick Bell came to the conclusion that racism is so deeply rooted in the makeup of American society that it has been able to reassert itself after each successive wave of reform aimed at eliminating it. So when others celebrated the success of Brown v. Board, for example, Derrick Bell became exasperated, thinking about the backlash against the very people who had made these gains possible. He felt that way until the end of his life, particularly watching a field he had incited, critical race theory, be captured by conservatives. He didn't live long enough to see the current ban on teaching about the histories of people of color, or anything about us at all that doesn't align with white interests, for that matter, in 16 states being banned and being considered in 20 more. But despite his disillusionment, he never stopped working and teaching and thinking about freedom and equality through legislation. We give thanks for Mr. B and how fortunate we are that he is our ancestor. And I'm so happy to give flowers to Gina B, who is here with us and whose work and commitment has been profoundly affecting for so many of the folks in this room, in prisons across the country, to artists around the world, to intellectuals who wish to work generatively with artists and organizers. If I was to tell you about all of the incredible programs that Gina Belafonte has done, it would take way more than the time I have up here, and I'm already being probably threatened by the Sandman somewhere. So I'll focus briefly on the quality and commitment underneath the myriad programs, conversations, interventions that she continues in multiple spheres with a kind of consistency and dependability that puts her in the great company of all those who love freedom and tirelessly create spaces where we not only dream it, but have the hard conversations to enact it. One thing I notice about Gina is that she shares and catalyzes her own relationships and experiences as an artist, as an advocate, a feminist, and a social justice warrior into a locus of connection for all those who want and need to be in the conversation about what we do next. She provides connection and community for countless organizers, for practicing musicians and artists, for writers, for actors, for producers, for incarcerated and formerly incarcerated folks. But she does more than just provide connection. She is a movement studier. She is a self-educator, a catalyzer, and a keeper and expander of circles of possibility. She elevates and centers the folks not meant to be heard so that the runway of struggle is lit up by the reminder of the strength we already have in our communities. If I had to come up with some slogans for the way her work metabolizes and lives in the bodies of those who participate in her vision, it's, ain't nobody gonna turn us around. It's could also be, we believe in us. It could also be, in the words of Maya Angelou, you may trod me down in the very dirt, but still, like dust, we'll rise. And these are the felt meanings of Gina's work. And as all of us know, this kind of work is essential to the nervous system and the fortitude of the movement. Another day in solidarity with each other. Congratulations, Gina, for this well-deserved award.
Largest prison system in the world are filled with those who are the victims of poverty.
Ooh, thank you, Kay.
The women who are disenfranchised,
of
young teenage mothers, are victims
about?
Of poverty. Poverty is knocking at our door all day long.
I too want to.
It sits in the mirror for us to look in
so
every morning. When we look at what's going on with the schools in this country,
I want to,
we build more prisons than we build schools.
I want to,
poverty is in our face all day long. Why is everybody behaving all of a sudden like
so
this is some great revelation?
That's a
we
cool
are
jacket.
Angry, we're upset, we look around for some
Derrick
comfort,
Bell,
and we don't find any.
What a force.
Well, we have to look
what
to ourselves. warrior. Because I think the last frontier moral of truth and hope in this country and, are the people themselves.
I'm just so much. I want to thank my mother and father, and I want to sort of cull in the ancestors, all those who have come before us, those who have paved a way for us to be here today, gathered in community. And I greet you, ladies and gentlemen, and distinguished guests and advocates for economic and racial justice. I would like to thank the Western Center on Law and Poverty for this distinguished honor and recognition. On behalf of my father and I, we are deeply grateful, I know he is, and we are honored to be acknowledged. Today we gather to honor the tireless efforts of the Western Center on Law and Poverty, a beacon of hope in the fight for justice and equity. This organization stands at the forefront, battling in courtrooms and city halls and the very heart of our capital to secure the fundamental rights of Californians. Their unrelenting commitment to securing housing, healthcare, and a strong safety net for those most vulnerable among us is a testament to their dedication to dismantling the deeply ingrained inequities that plague our society. The work of the Western Center on Law and Poverty serves as a powerful reminder of the crucial necessity to uplift our fellow Californians and by extension, all individuals grappling with the oppressive grip of poverty and institutional racism. The fight for economic and racial justice is not a mere abstraction. It is a pressing moral imperative. We must acknowledge that these injustices have persisted for far too long, breeding division and perpetuating suffering. By working towards equal economic structures, we can pave the way for a brighter, fairer future, where every Californian has the opportunity to thrive and reach their full potential. We are once again facing dark times. In a way, I ask myself, have we ever not faced them? War abroad and war at home seems to always be pervasive in this human condition. Greed and ego are running rampant once again, and I believe that if we don't have organizations like the Western Center on Law and Poverty, these bleak times would be even worse. We can no longer sit in ideation without deep critical analysis and come to truth and reconciliation. Humanity is at stake. As a Jewish person as well, I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge the ongoing conflict between Israel and Palestine, which is a complex and deeply rooted issue, which can be correlated with historical injustices in various parts of the world. One such correlation can be drawn to the history of slavery in the United States. Both scenarios involve the struggle for rights, territory, and the fundamental question of freedom. The long and painful history of slavery has marked by the systemic oppression and denial of basic human rights to a significant portion of the population. Similarly, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict has seen decades of tension, territorial disputes, and human rights violations, reminding us of the struggle for freedom and justice. Moreover, apartheid in South Africa provides another compelling comparison. Apartheid was a system of institutionalized racial segregation and discrimination that persisted for nearly half a century. During this period, non-white South Africans were subjected to systemic oppression and denial of their basic rights. In the case of Israel and Palestine, there are parallels to be drawn in terms of segregation and restriction of rights. The call for equal rights and justice in both situations mirrors the global demand for an end to apartheid in South Africa, Palestine, or anywhere it prevails. It is also essential to recognize the historical trauma of the Native Indigenous people of North America who faced the tragedy of genocide and displacement during the colonization of the Americas. The displacement and loss of land endured by Native peoples can be related to the displacement experienced by Palestinians in their homeland. The collective suffering, loss of cultural heritage, and ongoing struggles for justice experienced by both Native peoples and Palestinians underscore the importance of acknowledging and addressing historical injustices as we seek resolutions to these conflicts. While the situations in Israel and Palestine, the history of slavery in the United States, apartheid in South Africa, the genocide of Native and Indigenous people are distinct, they share common themes of struggle, oppression, and the ongoing pursuit of justice. Recognizing these correlations can help us approach these complex issues with empathy, understanding, and a commitment to working towards peaceful and just solutions for all involved together. In a world often beset by division and conflict, there is a bright beacon of hope that shines through the collective efforts of individuals and communities working towards peace and prosperity. Grassroots movements. They have consistently demonstrated the power of ordinary people coming together to create extraordinary change. To create this extraordinary change through grassroots organizing, people can address societal issues at their roots, nurturing the seeds of positive transformation. One of the most remarkable aspects of these movements is the unwavering commitment to truth and reconciliation, recognizing that healing the wounds of the past and fostering understanding between different groups are essential steps toward lasting peace. These movements exemplify the strength of empathy and the capacity for individuals to set aside differences, confront the painful truths of history, and extend a hand of reconciliation. As we continue this journey towards a more peaceful and prosperous world, it is crucial to remember that the path is often long and filled with challenges. However, the indomitable spirit of human beings, when united for a common purpose, can overcome even the most formidable obstacles. Through grassroots organizing and an unwavering commitment to truth and reconciliation, we can build a future where prosperity is shared, peace is cherished, and the division of the past are mended. Let us remain inspired by the countless individuals and communities tirelessly working towards these noble ideals, and may their efforts be a guiding light for generations to come. As we gather here today, let us not only commend the Western Center on Law and Poverty, but also recommit ourselves to the pursuit of economic and racial justice. Their unwavering dedication has set a powerful example of what can be achieved when we work collectively for the betterment of our society by striving to bring people out of poverty, dismantle institutional racism, and create equitable economic structures, we can chart a path towards a California and a world where every individual can live with dignity, opportunity, and hope. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Our prisons, the largest prison system in the world, are filled with those who are the victims of poverty. The women who are disenfranchised, young teenage mothers, are victims of poverty. Poverty is knocking at our door all day long. It sits in the mirror for us to look in every morning. When we look at what's going on with the schools in this country, we build more prisons than we build schools. Poverty is in our face all day long. Why is everybody behaving all of a sudden like this is some great revelation? We are angry, we're upset, we look around for some comfort, and we don't find any. Well, we have to look to ourselves, because I think the last frontier of truth and hope in this country are the people themselves.
And joining us tonight for a musical tribute to the late, great Harry Belafonte, please put your hands together and welcome Grammy Award nominee, Aloe Blacc.
Hang on to the world as it spins.
Time for Aloe Blacc.
I know. Who can talk after that? It's not fair. And so on behalf of Aloe and I, our beautiful friend, whenever Gina calls, we come. Make some noise for Gina Belafonte.
And for the wonderful legacy of Mr. B, who taught me so much, and I'm just so honored to be able to share this night with a song for Mr. B, and in honor of you as well, Gina. Love you. Love you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Aloe, your voice just unlocks so much. The power of the arts is so so evident in this moment. Your voice is an angel from heaven, and I'm so deeply appreciative. I'm appreciative of not only this honor for me, which always I'm terribly surprised, and I appreciate, and I'm not trying to be overly kind of coy. I really am sort of in the work just to make a difference. And it's interesting, my father passing and me stepping into this space in this way. So I appreciate my community showing up for me and helping me embody what I'm told I deserve, and I appreciate that so much, and thank you all so much. And I mean, the Western Center, you guys, I'm amazed and I'm humbled to be a part of this community now. Thank you.
More warm round of applause for Gina Belafonte, Aloe Blacc, and that beautiful presentation. Welcome back to the stage, our MC.
Give him another round of applause for everything we just saw. Truly beautiful. And that's a wrap. So on behalf of everyone at Western Center, congratulations again to all of their amazing honorees, and thank you all for joining us tonight in person and online to lend your support to the good work of Western Center on Law and Poverty. Be well. Thank you.
Well, the program may be over, but Garden Party 2023 continues out in the courtyard. Please join us for dessert, networking, beats by DJ TK, and don't forget to take your photo in the photo booth. Enjoy the rest of your Garden Party evening.